And it is now time to bring it
on. Let's do it. Let's do it.
Okay, Anne says, after months of prayer, and I believe through the leading of the Lord, I allowed my unsaved daughter and her boyfriend to live in my home. I'm a 75-year-old widow. I felt that under my influence, I could win them to the Lord. She now has Bible study and prayer with me and my other children, and I believe the Lord is beginning to move. My problem is my sister. She's saved. She told me I'm a sinner for allowing this, and until I make things right with the Lord, she cannot pray with me or have any spiritual contact. What's your take on this?
I think your sister is a Pharisee. And Pharisees don't see what God is doing. You prayed and perceived the way to win your daughter was to be loving and accepting. Now, a lot of people wouldn't want to do that. It looks like you're enabling them to live in sin, and what they're doing is cohabiting without marriage, and that's a no-no. But your sister should get her hands off the deal and see that what you're doing is working, and this is the way to win your daughter. So don't worry about what your sister says. You worry about what God told you, and you're doing what God said. All right?
Amen. Well, Mike says, is Islam the hammer of judgment on the wickedness of America? I continually ask God to protect the U.S. from evil and delay his judgment, but eventually, is it inevitable?
No. The judgment is never inevitable. Sodom and Gomorrah didn't have to be that. God said, if I find 10 righteous in the city, I'll spare it. So it didn't have to, but he couldn't find 10 righteous. And those men wanted to have sex with angels. I mean, how bad can you get? And the judgment finally fell. America is teetering on the balance. You know, we have forsaken the covenant of God. We've done abominations. We have exported abomination around the world. But at the same time, we're still the beacon of freedom. We're still the sending ground of the great missionary movement of the world. And so God actually loves America. So judgment is not inevitable, but there's some things on the horizon that don't look too good. And if we don't repent, some stuff is going to happen that we won't like at all.
All right. Doreen says, I want to be part of a harvest of blessings. I want to know what it means from the Bible and what I have to do to benefit from it.
Well,
harvest of blessings. Harvest.
Well, what you need to do to get a blessing is to follow the laws of the Lord. Do what he tells you to do. And the biggest thing is to love each other and don't say bad things about people. You know, love one another. This is my commandment, that you love one another. And if you want to be blessed, you take away the pointing of the finger, you take away slander, you take away a bad report, and you start loving people, and then you start doing unto others as you'd have them do unto you. And you put those rules into effect, and all of a sudden, blessing will come. In terms of finances given, it'll be given unto you, pressed down, good measure, running over, the Lord will heap into your bosom. So as you're giving from your resources, you'll begin to see a tremendous outpouring of finances. All right?
Amen. Chris says, the Old Testament is full of great warriors. Christians are being targeted and threatened daily and are attacked regularly. Why is there no modern-day army of God Christians? Is it because Jesus brought a new covenant in the New Testament, or are we Christians just weak and scared?
Well, we definitely are. They're great heroes of the faith. I mean, one of my dear friends is Reinhard Bonnke. I mean, he's leading millions to the Lord around the world, and they're people who are going forth in the name of the Lord who are doing tremendous things. I think what you see throughout CBN is not too shabby. But, you know, the Bible talks about he slayed them with the sword which came out of his mouth. The Word of God. We don't take up weapons like swords, but the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God which is in our mouth. And we speak the Word, and the Word will transform people's lives. Okay.
All right. Beth says, hello, Pat. My name is Beth, and I'm a Christian. However, I enjoy a glass of wine on occasion with my dinner. I don't drink anything other than wine, and only rarely. Is it wrong to enjoy a glass of wine sometimes with my meals? I really want to do what is right in the sight of God.
Well, if it's wrong, then Jesus is the Prince of Sinners, because he transformed water into wine. And the Bible says that God blesses us. He gives us oil to make our faces shine and wine to gladden our heart. And I think the Bible also says wine is a mocker, so you drink too much and you got in problems. But a glass of wine with your food, I mean, I don't see anything wrong with it, but, you know, it's, whatever.
Be drink and be merry.
Yeah, well, not exactly.